Trump held his first State of the Union address. Whenever these days Donald Trump grabs a microphone, you are in a surprise. The big surprise on Tuesday was Trump's tone was more conciliatory than in his inauguration speech. I mean, even that is a bizarre situation which we are right now. I mean, some people are already happy if he doesn't announce the Third World War and think this is a rather moderate step that he's undertaken. Imagine the situation which we are right now. But one thing was clear, that he made clear that for him foreign policy is a question of national security, and only of national security. Foreign policy to him is about military engagement. Human rights does not play a role in there. This is why, in his view, the war in Syria is first and foremost a question of US national security. Only reference he made to Syria in his speech was his pledge to wipe out ISIS. And obviously he left us in darkness how he wants to do that. We all know that wiping out ISIS, as much as we all agree upon that goal, is not the only means in stopping human rights abuses in that horrible war. And we all know that there is a price you have to pay when you intervene, when you stop human rights abuses, when you involve in a country. But Syria is a good case that there is also a price you have to pay if you do nothing, if you watch things happening. 6 years ago into the conflict, we have a variety of actors in Syria, a humanitarian catastrophe that is beyond all human imagination, and a war where regional and geopolitical interests are at stake. In short, the situation on the ground is more complex and more difficult to solve than it was ever before. When the UN Special Envoy Staffan de Mistura called the Syrian conflict, I quote, largest humanitarian catastrophe since World War II, he said that 2 years ago, in early 2015. In the meantime, we have all witnessed the horrifying siege of Aleppo, the bombing of hospitals, and the blockade of humanitarian access. We have seen millions of people forced to leave the country, risking their lives in the hands of human traffickers or on the land routes to Europe. Only a minority has made it to our country and to other member states of the European Union. Latest numbers by the United Nations, 6.5 million people internally displaced, 13.5 million people currently in need of humanitarian assistance inside Syria. And the regime that triggered the conflict by using violence to end, let's not forget that in the beginning, peaceful protests, is still in place. And obviously, thanks to the support of Moscow, Bashar al-Assad has been able to continue his policy of destruction of his own country. Assad and his henchmen have been torturing the Syrian people by cutting access to humanitarian and medical aid. And as we all know, the situation in Syrian prisons is a situation that is out of any description. And I do not want to quote what I have here in my speech, because I think you're all aware of the situation, how it is in the prisons. Let me make this clear. Assad and Putin are not the only perpetrators. I strongly condemn all kinds of violence committed in Syria. This holds true as much for Assad as it does for ISIS, Jabhat Fatah al-Sham, and every other organization or individual trampling human dignity in Syria. As the United Nations confirmed just yesterday, all parties committed war crimes in Syria. But it is important to remember that Assad was the one who started this conflict. He's the one who is waging war against his very own people that he was elected by to protect his country. So where do we stand now? It has been heartbreaking to see the human suffering. But let me tell you, from the viewpoints of a politician dedicated to foreign policy It has also been heartbreaking to see the struggling of the international community to respond to this challenge. The longer the international community stood by, the deeper Syria got drawn into the conflict. Just 2 days ago, the United Nations Security Council failed to pass sanctions against the regime for the use of chemical weapons. Without question, there is no easy answer to the conflict in Syria. The UN Security Council has been blocked by the veto powers, not only Russia, but as well China. The ICC has been unable to act on its own, as Syria is no party to the treaty. So many different countries have different interests at stake in the conflict right now, that peace will be very difficult to broker. So what can we do? Maybe we should try to change the perspectives. We should look at Syria not through the actor's lens, but through victim's lens. Sustained peace needs reconciliation. Extremely difficult and painful process, but a very necessary one at the same time. Justice is a key element of that process. In connection with today's topic, accountability for mass atrocities in Syria, this means accountability on an international as well on a national level. Just last October, my parliamentary group introduced a bill explicitly calling upon the German government to increase support of criminal justice for Syria and for Iraq. If there is no way on getting the Syrian situation in front of the International Criminal Court at the moment, due to the obvious veto of Russia and China, we have to think about alternatives. One alternative on the international level would be a special tribunal. Unfortunately, this faces more or less the same problems like the ICC. Here, the so-called universal jurisdiction on the national level comes into play. My party has long been fighting in the German Bundestag to improve the legal framework for crimes committed abroad to be put to justice in Germany. Thanks to the German International Criminal Code, Völkerrechtsstrafgesetzbuch, established under the Red-Green Coalition when we were in government 2002, nowadays we have a legal framework to bring perpetrators of the worst human rights violations, genocide, crimes against humanity, and war crimes to court here in Germany. We all can contribute to the success of these proceedings. NGOs such as the ECCHR play a crucial role in filling concrete cases like they did yesterday. And thanks for that, by the way. Refugees in Germany are important to help bring about justice. In many cases already, they have helped investigations with information. The Bundeskriminalamt has already received 3,900 hints from refugees only in Germany. We politicians can also contribute. We are responsible for the legal, technical, and manned framework of such proceedings. Martin Luther King Jr. said, "Injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere." Justice will not undo crimes of the past, but it will help heal wounds. Justice serves the victims. It puts victims first. This is why I applaud the Heinrich-Böll Foundation for organizing this conference, and I thank you all for being here today. Thank you.
Yes. Thank you very much, Cem Özdemir, head of the Green Party, for his introductory remarks today. I have the pleasure to moderate the first panel with Chris Woods, Lotte Leicht and Andreas Krüger, whom I will introduce later. My name is Wolfgang Kaleck. I'm heading the European Center for Constitutional and Human Rights, who is co-hosting this conference with the Heinrich-Böll Foundation, Barbara Unmüßig, The director of the foundation made it in time, so you could have been with us as well. So a warm welcome to all of you, but a warm welcome especially to our Syrian friends. Although I have a little bit of a difficulty to call Anwal Buni and Mazen Davish our Syrian friends, because they are at home here, especially when it comes to our office, because I think we have seen nearly daily in the last weeks in the preparation of all of this. A very warm welcome also to those Syrian human rights organizations who explicitly support the already mentioned complaint, the Syrian Center for Research and Statistics, Davlati and Zaman Alwazi. But also very warm welcome to the international colleagues from FIDH, from CJAB, Stephen Rapp, from Euromed Rights, from the Open Society Justice Initiative, and from the British law firm Guernica 37, who all made it here to discuss with us, partly on the panel, but unfortunately not all on the panel, because we were a little bit surprised about the positive reaction to this conference. So as you might see, and as you might then also will realize later on, we overloaded the program a little bit. Instead of two panels, we're having three panels tonight, all of them quite short given the expertise and the knowledge of the panelists. And therefore, also apologies to everybody, not only for overloading, but also not having a public discussion, because otherwise we would sit here next week. There will be time for a discussion. We have said that there will be a break of 30 minutes from the end of this panel to the beginning of next panel. I would say it will be more or less 30 minutes, and I'm happy not to be in the position to call all of you back from the break. And there will be an hour after the whole conference from 9 to 10, where we also hope that there is some opportunity to chat. You might ask yourself why the Heinrich-Böll Foundation and why the European Center for Constitutional and Human Rights is convening this conference today. I would say in the case of the Heinrich-Böll Foundation, it doesn't need a longer explanation, because in this same room there have been a lot of important meetings all over the last years on Syria. Even some of today's panelists have been speaking here on other occasions. Anthony Nord is heading a long-term project on Syria, and so it's a pleasure for us as a legal human rights organization to be supported and cooperating with the Böll Foundation, not only in this evening, but also on a larger project. And part of this larger project was yesterday's criminal complaint to the Federal Prosecutor's Office, which shouldn't be in the focus of this evening. Therefore, my colleague Patrick Kroker, who's the author of the complaint, together with Anwal Buni and Mazen Davish, will talk about it later on in this evening. But the idea of this evening was to contextualize the complaint and our work in a larger frame. But without doubt, today's evening is dedicated to crime and punishment, to crime and the call for justice and accountability. That's all three panels will try to put light on this in a different way. Of course, we had a difficulty which is very obvious for you. Which crimes are we focusing on? Because there have been so many crimes committed, some of them addressed by the Böll Foundation, by us, by some of the panelists. But obviously, we won't be able to cover all of them. We should have and we could have talked about the crimes against the Yazidi women. Actually, I was hoping, Cem Özdemir, that you will talk a little bit about it, because your home country, Baden-Württemberg, does a lot to take care of these women and to give them a psychosocial company as well as legal help. But you will later on you will figure out that this panel and the other panels are addressing some of those crimes. Obviously, and I think most of you will agree on that, obviously torture is one of the most egregious crimes, and therefore our complaint to the Federal Prosecutor's Office, as well as tonight's conference, is very much focused on torture. Also due to the work of organizations like Human Rights Watch, who published the very important report "If the Dead Could Speak," where they analyzed around about 50,000 photos delivered by the military photographer with the pseudonym Cesar, but also Amnesty International with his latest report from a couple of weeks ago, Human Slaughterhouse on the Sadnaya prison, dedicated a lot of their work throughout the last years on torture. And talking about Sadnaya prison, we could also talk about Tadmor prison, shows also that we're talking not only about the last 6 years since 2011, but we're talking about a method, a repression method, which is like the DNA of the two Assad regimes. We're talking about systematic torture. And nobody who studies the documents, who studies the witness testimonies, will deny that this is systematic. This is a policy, and therefore we are talking about the responsibility of the highest members of the government and of the leaders of the secret services in Syria. It's quite important because we are addressing the Federal Prosecutor's Office in Germany, and their main bulk of their work is dedicated to ISIS, or as today's arrest show, to al-Nusra. Those people, may they be investigated and prosecuted, but those people who happened to come to Germany, and what our intention is with today's conference, but also with the complaint, is to call for a more strategic approach in prosecution, and to call for prosecution of higher-ups. So a lot to discuss with a number of fantastic experts, to begin with Lotte Leicht, who is a trained Danish lawyer. One is forgetting it because she's one of the most international connected human rights lawyers, advocates in the world. As the head of Human Rights Watch in Europe, she sits in Brussels, in the Brussels office, but is often coming to Berlin because she sits on the board of the two host organizations, the Heinrich-Böll-Foundation, as well as on ECCHR board. And she is going to give us a short introduction about crime and accountability and the difficulties we have to face in that struggle. So, Lotte.
Thank you very much, and also thank you very much for inviting me also to be here tonight. This is an extraordinary important theme, and I am absolutely delighted that both the Heinrich-Böll-Stiftung and the European Center for Constitutional and Human Rights, together with Syrian victims and Syrian lawyers, have taken up this theme with such a vigor in Germany, and I will try to also explain why I believe this is so important. Wolfgang asked me to first sort of give the broad picture in terms of the abuses that we have been documenting, and the war crimes and the crimes against humanity that have marked the conflict in Syria. As an organization, Human Rights Watch have documented since 2011, since the peaceful uprise, since the peaceful protests were responded to by a brutal regime with killings, with detentions, with torture. We have documented an escalation, both in terms of gravity and in terms of scope of crimes carried out, indeed, as Sam Özdemir said, by both sides. But let me be clear from the very outset here tonight, there's no balance of abuse in Syria. There are crimes committed by all parties, and I will go into to what kind of crimes we've documented, but there is no balance in terms of the scale of the abuses. As an organization, we believe that approximately 90% of civilian casualties in Syria can be assigned to the crimes committed by Assad forces, by militias of the government, including Hezbollah, that is supported by Iran, and now also by Russian supportive strikes in Syria. In terms of the kind of crimes and the gravity of the crimes that we have been documenting, they are of a scale that we have not seen for a long time, and I have worked in many, many wars around the world. They are overwhelming, and we have documented bombings of civilian areas, targeted bombings of bakeries, of markets, of schools, and of hospitals. We've documented the use of indiscriminate and indeed illegal weapons, including chemical weapons, cluster munitions, barrel bombs, incendiary weapons, and most recently now the use of bunker buster bombs for the purpose of penetrating into deep cellars where people had taken refuge in the city of Aleppo. We've documented executions, sieges, so starvation as a means of warfare, preventing civilians from leaving, from fleeing areas of conflict, and preventing much needed assistance and aid, including food, clean water, and medicine from entering into places where people desperately need them. We talk about Syria, we talk about ceasefires in Syria, but today reality in Syria is that if you try to deliver food to some of these besieged areas, you're shot at. In terms of crimes documented by armed groups, they have also been atrocious and they have also escalated markedly over the years. We've documented indiscriminate shelling. We have documented killings, indiscriminate killings, including the use of car bombs, suicide bombs, kidnappings, executions, and also sieges. We've documented enslavement of women and rape. So the whole scale is there. And then there is, and that is what this complaint that was filed yesterday is really all about. There are the crimes that are being committed behind the walls of the Syrian governments, many, many detention centers and prisons. And they are in different branches of the government, military branches, intelligence branches, and government branches. But the abuses are of a scale that when you read the testimonies, both from victims and witnesses, people who actually survived these places and managed to be released, often due to bribes that their families had to pay. But also testimonies from defectors, people from the regime that simply couldn't live with this anymore and fled themselves. They talk about torture of the worst kind. They talk about ill treatment and starvation of the worst kind. People are losing up to 30 kilos after 6 months in prison. People are not being treated for just mere conditions in terms of health. People go mentally insane and refuse to eat. It is barbarian. People are executed in the night. If you read Amnesty International's most recent report, it is absolutely horrific reading. And yet that is actually not what the debate is in our countries. We still have it, or we have moved to a debate in our countries where we are basically seeing the people fleeing this kind of inhumanity as a problem. That's the problem we are talking about and emphasizing so much on, rather than helping these people, giving them the protection that they need and that they have a right to, but also assisting them in their efforts to take the perpetrators of these crimes to justice. So why is justice so important? Let me just read a quote by Assad. On January 20th, 2015, Assad, he said, and it was sort of responding to the photos that came out with CSAR. And I quote, "You can bring photographs from anyone and say this is torture. There's no verification of any of this. So it's all just allegations without any evidence," unquote. This comes from a man who is well aware, of course, of these abuses. But it comes from a man who feels absolutely certain that he will also get away with his crimes. And this is the problem. Justice is not a moral luxury for victims. Victims and those who have survived crimes, but also loved ones of those who haven't, they have a right to justice. They have a right to this measure of peaceful closure to move on. And it is equally important that the perpetrators of these crimes will be put on notice that the calculation that they have been making for years now, namely that crime pays, that crimes will get them to where they want to be it staying in power, keeping privileges, whatever it may be, but crime is the way to go. That is a calculation that we need to upset, and justice is part of that puzzle. Sam Özdemir rightfully said that we have lost fights in the Security Council. Russia and China have vetoed resolutions referring the situation in Syria to the International Criminal Court, and the only way that the criminal court could get jurisdiction would have been through a Security Council referral, simply because Syria is not a state party to the court. That was cynically vetoed, like so many other things, including sanctions for the use of chemical weapons just a few days ago. So what do? We use other means, because we simply have to upset the calculation that crime pays. And I would say that out of despair, we finally found also a new way on the international scene, and then I will go back to universal jurisdiction. But we worked through the UN General Assembly, and in December, finally, the General Assembly acted where the Security Council had failed. Of course, the General Assembly could not set up a hybrid or a special court, could not give a court special powers to investigate crimes in Syria. But the General Assembly of the United Nations did the second best thing, and it was important. It established a special mechanism that is now to be staffed and funded, including hopefully by Germany, for the purpose of gathering and preserving evidence with a view of preparing criminal cases. So now perpetrators should be on notice. Because for years, a commission of inquiry, also set up by the United Nations, but by the Human Rights Council in Geneva, have been collecting evidence of crimes, and you will hear more about that later on. But now there's another UN mechanism that will analyze that evidence, that will gather additional evidence, and that will start preparing criminal cases for prosecution, wherever that may be. And that could, for instance, also be before national courts using universal jurisdiction if perpetrators suddenly show up. And believe you me, they tend to. It has happened before. The first case of a perpetrator prosecuted before an international special criminal tribunal set up by the Security Council was a case of, his name was Tadic, but it was also a prison guard or prison master who had committed gross crimes in terms of torture in Bosnia-Herzegovina. His case was prepared in Germany. It was almost ready for prosecution in Germany. And then Germany handed it over to an international special tribunal for the former Yugoslavia because it was the first case it could take on. I foresee that this will happen the other way around, that this special UN mechanism will deliver the evidence to various courts who can actually handle the cases. That's the good news. The next good news, and this is really good news, is that victims are now fighting back with the help of Syrian lawyers and organizations like the ECCHR. They're fighting back in the most peaceful way that one could fight back, but they're serious. And they are taken seriously because what they have experienced, the testimonies that they gather and the cases that they put forward, they have merits, and they are strong cases. And the perpetrators of the crimes that these cases involved, they will see justice one day. The wheels of justice tend to move slowly, but they do move. And sometimes people like myself are impatient, but I have become more patient with age. And I have seen that those who believed that they would get away with crimes and that crimes would get them into the power positions that they wanted to be in, they lost out. Finally, I would say that there is one additional aspect to the issue of justice and investigating cases, and that is the aiding and abetting aspect. And that means that it's not just perpetrators directly linked to the crimes in Syria, be it by rebel forces or be it by the Syrian government. It is also those who ruthlessly calculate that they can beef up those who are already known for committing atrocious war crimes by giving them weapons and assisting them in using those weapons in killings. And if they are in doubt, they should read another case of international justice that has moved forward, namely the case against Charles Taylor, the then president of Liberia, who was found guilty of atrocious crimes before an international or hybrid court, but not for crimes committed in Liberia, although he is certainly responsible for crimes there, but for crimes committed in neighboring Sierra Leone, where he was aiding and abetting crimes by giving weapons knowingly to rebels that were then using them for committing war crimes in Sierra Leone. Human Rights Watch actually handed over a letter, and we did that, and it's back in 2012, and it was a difficult process just in handing over this letter, where we enumerated crimes committed by weapons given and transferred to the Assad regime. And we gave this letter to Rosoboron Export, the biggest arms manufacturing facilitator in Russia. And we gave them the letter with a notice that they should take notice now because they were at great risk, and this is back in 2012, from becoming complicit in these crimes, aiding and abetting them. Of course, that is also not a one-sided story. There's not one side just aiding and abetting one side in this conflict. There are many sides. But everyone should be put on notice as the wheels of justice become more serious. And that means that there are many fronts for investigations also by prosecutors like the Federal Prosecutor of Germany to pursue, and they are important. Let me finally end just with one plea, and that goes directly to the German government. And I do this because you are here, Andreas, not representing the government but the foreign ministry, but maybe you can just take back the message. Justice is not free. It costs money. And we need to see governments who are persistently, and we are happy about that, don't get me wrong, but persistently saying there needs to be justice for the crimes committed in Syria. Perpetrators of crimes need to be held accountable. That's fine. Words are cheap. And what governments need to do is to back up those words now with commitments of both expertise, political support, and indeed financial support. And that goes both for the prosecutors of Federal Prosecutor's Office here in Germany. They need additional capacities to deal with this. And Germany is uniquely placed to deal with the crimes in Syria due to the amount of victims that are in Syria and the Syrian lawyers who are here also working on them. But it also needs to beef up some money for this new UN General Assembly mechanism. And the Dutch government has actually set the bar very high. One day before the vote on the resolution, they already sort of jumped the gun, believing that it would go through. So of course it did, but by donating per year 1 million euros. Now, if we could do that, you know, in the same scale, Germany is a much bigger country, from Germany, then the mechanism can start working immediately. So please, come up with the money and let us work on these important issues. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you very much, Lotte, for reminding us that there is no balance of abuses. For quoting Assad, and I'm sure that Mazen, Anwar, and Patrick will find some words about how strong the evidence against the Assad government in the case of torture is. And thank you very much, Lotte, for reminding us that there is also complicity of other actors outside of Syria for this war. You talked about adding and abetting, and I'm quite happy to give you two good news. The one is sometimes justice is not as slow as we normally experience, and so we just have received good news about a case we filed together with the organization, French organization Sherpa, against the French construction firm Lafarge, because they worked in the IS dominated zone near Raqqa, and we sued them for adding and abetting ISIS. And today they did what every company does in those cases: they denied that there is any of the facts are true, and today they admitted publicly that they are involved. And they have to run through, they announced an internal investigation. Of course, this is not enough, but still, this is an important first step. And the second good news is that we decided this week to look into a case of a German company who delivered surveillance technology to Syria. One more German company, I'm saying, who are delivering these kind of supplies to repressive regimes, and who announced them on big fairs in the Near East, because there is a lot of money to gain in this business. Talking about complicity, I'm happy to have you here again, Chris Woods. We have been sitting on a panel together a couple of weeks ago, and it was on the drones war. And Chris is London-based, and he's an investigative journalist. And he runs an organization which, I mean, the name speaks for itself, Airwars. So he and his colleagues gather incredible lot of evidence about Airwars, and Lotte already introduced this issue. We have a lot of illegal, against international humanitarian law, airstrikes, as well of the coalition, as well of the Russians and other actors in Syria. And I'm also looking forward, Chris, I'm looking forward to hear from you about that. And I'm also looking forward to hear some remarks from you about the latest UN report, the Inquiry Commission, which, by the way, in its conclusions, called upon the national states, not only the Syrian actors, not only the international community, but also the national states, to enforce their possibilities on accountability. So we're talking about the same thing. Chris, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, and it's an absolute pleasure to be here tonight, and particularly to see so many people from Syrian civic society here. It is really a fantastic group of people in the audience. As Wolfgang says, I've been asked to talk about international airstrikes as a particular issue in Syria. When we think of airstrikes and civilian casualties in Syria, I guess the first thing that comes to mind for all of us is the Assad regime's use of thousands of air and helicopter attacks on rebel-held civilian areas. And the barrel bomb, as we know, is the cause of death for tens of thousands of Syrian non-combatants. But as we also know, Syria these days is also an international conflict involving many nations. Since 2014, as many as 20,000 airstrikes by 18 international powers are alleged between them to have killed as many as 15,000 non-combatants in Syria. So international powers on their own are part of the problem in Syria these days. And I think one challenge getting international engagement here is that four of the five permanent members of the UN Security Council are presently at war in Syria. That's the United States, Russia, the UK, and France, all involved in the conflict directly now. This international military engagement in Syria has been framed throughout by war crimes, by a response or non-response to them, or in their active commissioning. If you remember back in 2013, the Obama administration and the UK government shied away from a military response to the Assad regime's use of chemical weapons on civilian populations. As yesterday's UN investigation on Aleppo made clear, the use of chemical, cluster, and incendiary munitions on civilian populations has continued unhindered right up to the fall of Eastern Aleppo in December and beyond. What eventually triggered US intervention in Syria was instead, as we know, the rise of so-called Islamic State, both for the terror threat it represented to the West and for the atrocities ISIL was committing in Iraq and Syria. Since September 23rd, 2014, that US-led coalition has conducted around 7,500 airstrikes inside Syria against ISIL, more than 95% of those strikes by the United States. To date, the US has admitted 115 civilian deaths in Syria, though our own estimated air wars is of at least 1,100 fatalities in these same actions. The lawfulness of that US and allied engagement in Syria has been questioned, though the legitimacy of its ISIL targets is generally not in doubt. So most of the civilians slain by the coalition were not unlawfully killed, as lawyers put it. Instead, they were so-called collateral damage in relatively precise airstrikes. This is the West framing of this. Even so, there have been repeated concerns raised. Last year, Amnesty International identified more than 300 civilian fatalities in just 10 coalition incidents and raised significant concerns about both proportionality and discrimination. This too is potential war crimes territory, though an area often paid less attention to by us in the media. The focus is quite rightly heavily on Assad, but there are challenges around war crimes for the coalition as well. And holding the US-led alliance to account has proved extremely challenging. Of those nations bombing in Syria, only the US, UK, Canada, and France have said where and when they strike. Other coalition nations have continued to bomb with impunity, refusing to say where or when they attack, and ensuring they cannot be held accountable when things go wrong. Embarrassingly, I think, the Netherlands, Belgium, Denmark, and Australia to this day refuse to say almost anything about their military actions in Syria, making public accountability impossible. And countries like Italy and Germany, while not directly participating in hostilities, are providing lethal intelligence to other allies who then carry out strikes in Syria. Arab nations Jordan, Saudi Arabia, the United Arab Emirates, and Bahrain all insist their airstrikes have killed no civilians in Syria, yet these same nations, using the same planes, the same pilots, and the same bombs, are accused by the UN of killing at least 6,000 Yemenis in that troubled nation's ongoing war. Are we really expected to believe that in Syria all is perfection, while elsewhere official monitors report carnage? Then there are the unilateral campaigns which continue to wreak havoc in Syria. The United States is conducting a parallel war against Fatah al-Sham, the former al-Qaeda in Syria. Dozens of these targeted assassinations have also caused significant civilian casualties, according to reports. Britain and Israel have carried out their own unilateral targeted strikes, while in the past few days, Iraq has begun targeting alleged ISIL facilities inside Syria. Iranian drones have also conducted strikes around Aleppo in support of the regime, and Turkey has gone further still, invading northern Aleppo province with ground troops to prosecute attacks against both ISIL and local Kurdish factions. And just in the last few days, with the fall of al-Bab, the estimate is that as many as 500 civilians have died in that individual Turkish campaign. With so many nations now at war within Syria, it's often unclear where the incentive for peace lies. While the coalition's actions in Syria are often troubling, it's those of Russia which have rightly caused uproar. When Moscow intervened militarily in September 2015, it looked as if the Assad regime was on its last legs. More than 10,000 airstrikes later, Assad's forces have recaptured Aleppo and are on the offensive across many parts of Syria. Russia has apparently embraced the view of the Assad regime that all civilian non-combatants outside government control are effectively targetable rebels. Key monitors like the Syrian Network for Human Rights, which is here today, I think, say almost 5,000 civilians have already died in these brutal Russian airstrikes. Overall, as many as 13,000 civilian deaths have been alleged from Russian actions. On countless occasions, Russia deliberately targets civilian areas and infrastructure. As the UN said in its report into the fall of Aleppo issued just this week, quote, between July and December 2016, Syrian and Russian forces carried out daily airstrikes, claiming hundreds of lives and reducing hospitals, schools, and markets to rubble. Back in September 2015, the Syrian Air Force was decrepit and barely functional. One side effect of Russia's intervention has been that Syria's own air force has now been repaired, its crews retrained, its munition stocks replenished. In turn, this now means it's often impossible for those affected to distinguish between Russian and regime airstrikes. You can't tell them apart anymore. Aircraft have repeatedly dropped cluster bombs, incendiaries, and chemical munitions on urban locations in Syria, resulting in significant deaths. As the UN notes for Aleppo, this, quote, suggests a willful disregard by all sides for international humanitarian law rules with regard to proportionality and distinction, or for the requirement to take all feasible precautions to avoid incidental loss of human life, injury, or damage to civilian objects. Yet despite the video and photographic evidence, the eyewitness testimonies, the names of the dead, and the thorough field investigations, both Russia and the Assad regime continue to insist their strikes have only killed terrorists in Syria. It's not clear what moral leverage the United States and its allies have here when only the US has admitted to any civilian deaths in Syria. When the UK and the Netherlands find themselves bragging, just like Russia, that their bombs somehow, miraculously, also only kill terrorists, it's little wonder that Moscow feels it can act with impunity. At the most basic level, affected civilians in Syria have a right to know which nations are killing and maiming their loved ones and to hold them to account. To their shame, many world powers presently make this impossible. A first step would be recognition that key world powers are often a part of the problem when it comes to violence in Syria, rather than the solution. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much, Chris, for reminding us what air wars mean, in fact, and what damage they cause, even if they seem legitimate, or wars of action, actions of war who seem legitimate can actually violate international humanitarian law. Although you put it already right, that many of those damages are lawful under international humanitarian law. And so I wouldn't say the lawyers call it collateral damage. The majority of the lawyer would call collateral damage, but there are also lawyers like us who call for a reform of international humanitarian law, and who call for accountability for actions, for illegitimate actions in those wars. And I'm sorry to again mention a case of ours, but I think it's appropriate to mention the case of the Kunduz bombing. Some of you might remember that there was an incident where a German colonel ordered the bombing of a truck in near Kunduz in Afghanistan, and this case has just taken by the European Court of Human Rights in Strasbourg. It's a case against Germany and the lack of prosecution. And that is, talking about Germany, one of those contradictions of this country, who undertakes a lot in the international forum to call upon accountability, international criminal justice, but sometimes is not realizing or is not complying with it or with his own promises. I'm not asking you about the Kunduz case. I'm not asking you about drones, Andreas Krüger. In fact, we're very happy to have you here. We invited you because you act currently as ambassador for the negotiations in Syria, and you head the division for Iraq, Syria, and Lebanon, and the anti-IS strategy in Germany's Federal Foreign Office. And we would like, of course, we would like to hear a little bit about your answers on Lotte's questions about the role of Germany. The role of Germany, of course, you are often in Geneva, and the Geneva talks are not particularly dealing with accountability, but we would like to know a little bit from you about the status of the peace talks, but also what role does accountability plays in this talks, and how much does Germany do in Geneva, in The Hague, in Berlin, and in Karlsruhe to guarantee that there will be at least at some day accountability for all those crimes we've been talking about?
Well, first of all, again, thank you for inviting me. Of course, it's always difficult to somehow bridge the reality in Syria, the gruesome reality in Syria, with the diplomatic niceties of Geneva. But I think also Lotte's intervention reminded us that the violence in Syria is not, so to speak, a side effect of the war or of the conflict. The violence in Syria is, so to speak, the very political DNA of the regime. It's the whole effort in Geneva is how to change that DNA, so to speak, that political DNA. To summarize it very shortly, the political talks which have just started in Geneva, and I just come from that to be here, otherwise I would still be in Geneva, are not going very well. That probably was expected, but still it is, even if something goes bad that and you expect it to go bad, it's still depressing. The opposition, to cut it short, is overall actually exemplary and very constructive, and I do this now for a couple of years, so it's the best equipped, most constructive approach of a Syrian opposition delegation I've seen so far. They really do everything that can be expected from them under these difficult circumstances. They cover a very, very broad spectrum, you know, as in every political gathering, there are many fantastic voices in there. There are also some people in there whose outlook, so to speak, ideology-wise and so on, I would not agree. Nevertheless, they all have subscribed to a vision paper already last year, and I think it's a very good basis for a political transition. And so that's also why I was among those who introduced that vision paper in New York last year. Of course, Lotte is absolutely right in focusing also on the Russian role. And again, I think also in the last couple of days, Russia overpromised and underdelivered in this particular round of negotiations. The ceasefire to say that it's only partially holding is already saying, how should I say, an optimistic interpretation of events. And there are many violations, particularly by the regime, not only, but particularly by the regime. And what so far Russia has not achieved is that the Russian, the government delegation, the Syrian government delegation, would conduct these talks in a constructive and forward-looking manner, just the opposite so far. Again, that's not much of a surprise, but different to what Russia actually said it would do. And the vote, you alluded to that in the United Nations Security Council on the chemical weapons, was another example of basically backing the regime. One word to that, actually, what I found particularly depressing in that is that not only Russia and China vetoed it, but there was at least one vote against it from Bolivia. And if my memory is correct, I think there were five abstentions also. And in this, you know, and if you read the if you read the resolution, there was really nothing, how to say, inflammatory, over the top in it, so to speak. It actually should have been a resolution very easy to vote in favor of. So the prospects for a political solution are not very high. The first chapter, so to speak, will end either Friday or Saturday. Then there will be a break. I expect them to start somehow mid March again. But I think one of the positive aspects of the last 7 days or so is actually that it became very clear how inseparable accountability is from a political transition, and how important it also is to keep the accountability question on the table. We, on the one hand, of course, the whole agenda of these talks is structured according to UN Security Council Resolution 2254, and there's an operative point number 4 in it, and it gives the United Nations Special Envoy Stephanie Mistura the mandate to conduct these talks, particularly talking about governance, constitution, and election. And it's so he created these three baskets, so to speak, to talk about governance, constitution, and elections. I think it's very obvious that when you talk about governance, checks and balances in a transitional government, empowering those who want accountability, constitution, of course, true independence of judiciary, etc., 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 but also elections, which basically, you know, symbolize political accountability, and election law, which should, for example, exclude those which are which committed war crimes, in my opinion. So I think that's one thing where we have to make sure, and we have to support all efforts to make accountability an inseparable part of these negotiations from day one, so to speak. And the second track, so to speak, is to keep accountability on the political table. There is a Commission of Inquiry report, which actually we also issued a statement on, and tomorrow we are organizing an event with many delegations present in the Syria talks with the Commission of Inquiry. And Lotte definitely knows that Germany was among those countries who very much fought for the establishment of the Commission of Inquiry. To answer your direct question, I can't say the number yet by how much money we will support the IIIM, this new mechanism. But to use this, I'm very hopeful and optimistic that we will do. And you know that I wouldn't say that on this kind of, how should I say, stage, if I'm not really hopeful and optimistic that we do. Sebastian, who is here, works very hard on that, actually just assuring that. So he's the guy. But I think also another really important aspect of it, and I think one has to give Stephanie Mistura a lot of credit for it. You know, he's often criticized, sometimes wrongly, sometimes rightly. I just actually criticized him for something I won't talk about here quite vividly 48 hours ago. I think one thing you cannot accuse him of is he's really trying to get as many civil voices, voices of Syrians, into these talks as his mandate allows. He created a room for civil society. He has a special women advisory board. And I think he also, I think he really goes out of his way to bring all these questions into the, so to speak, hardcore of the negotiations. Of course, he has to walk a certain balance, And I'm sure you have, I mean, some of you who follow this as intensive as I do and many others here probably have seen, you know, all these articles in, like, I don't know, RT and other wonderful media who say, oh yeah, he's on his way out, you know, all these nice little things that you can do. If you want to undermine the authority of somebody, but I think he really tries to do that, and so it's again also I think very important that also Geneva provides a stage for also a lot of the victims of the crimes we talked about to be heard. Actually, more or less, I think 2 hours ago we co-sponsored an event by the Women's Advisory Council, the women who would counsel the opposition, to talk about accountability in Geneva. And I think these things are extremely important. I think to one more thing before I stop. I think one of the particularly sad experience of last year was that the whole attempt last year also was to work on what is in diplomatic language often called confidence building measures. You know, one of the prime confidence building measures, of course, would be release of prisoners. I say release of prisoners and not exchange of prisoners. There also are prisoners within the hand of the armed opposition groups, and there's actually an absolute gruesome and dehumanizing trade going on between some of those, especially hardcore Islamist groups, especially in Idlib, and some of the fighting we see is actually about that, how should I say, human cargo, to use a not very good word for that. But there's no question that by a large majority, most of the most of the victims of these things are in government-run facilities. And I say facilities because many of these things are not prisons, not even the Syrian sense of the word. These are dungeons, cellars, really the worst possible institutions that you can imagine. And I think there's a very clear message. The Syrian government doesn't want to build confidence. They don't want these talks to succeed, and so they blocked every effort so far to release even, let's say, the little children, the women. And I remember one discussion on Friday where another women's group actually also held a public event in Geneva, and one woman said, these are not, these people are not taken into custody. They are basically kidnapped, because most of these people, you know, the wives, the husbands, wherever, they don't know if they're where they are, if they're still alive, et cetera, et cetera. So it's a totally different thing than, under the, normal authoritarian government, of which there are already too many in this world. So all these efforts have been so far completely blocked. Again, that's why I think the only way really to change that equation is by political change. This is what we are trying to support in Geneva, not only in words, but also actually in deeds. We support also the institutions, which basically the whole logistics of the opposition, in order for them to give them, the good panel to work from. And even if the chances are not very good, I think that's the only way we really can change the equation. I'm not believing in, just a little bit of betterment of this government, because as I started, violent repression is a part of the very DNA of that regime.
Thank you very much, Andreas Krüger. Three minutes left, 1 minute for a last remark, Chris. So Chris is open to discuss with all of you in the upcoming break. Lotte?
Thank you very much. Then I will take 2 minutes.
Assuming that.
Yes. Well, let me just immediately sort of tag on to what Andreas has been saying to really drive home that Assad's claim on power really depends solemnly on his continuation of gross violations of international humanitarian law and human rights law. No doubt about that. I think it is important, however, to understand, and it surprises many of us, that with the military might of the Assad regime, supported by Iran, supported by Russia now, it is quite extraordinary that there is someone still fighting back. And we need to understand, I believe, why, if we are going to also come to negotiations where the fighting will somehow diminish. And I am absolutely convinced that the fighting back is taking place because of all the violations and their contribution to motivation to fight back. People know that they are not on the winning end, but they are motivated to fight back because they have seen their loved ones tortured, executed, disappeared, hit by incendiary bombs, which is one of the worst kind. I mean, when you see people burn up, then you will never forget it. And let me assure you, you will never go to a grill party with the same sort of happiness again when you've been on the ground and documenting this. That motivation will not go unless I believe that there will be a part of the peace talks that will truly stand up for the people of Syria. And that needs to be Germany and the Europeans. That needs to be your role. And you outlined a number of the issues here, and they are important, and I firmly believe that. I just believe that the Europeans need to be far more vocal and loud on the confidence building measures that you're talking about, because it's not that loud. We need to hear, and this is something where the backers of, be it extreme armed groups that are also kidnapping people and holding people hostages, or be it the reset regime, their backers can start by delivering on one key issue. And if they can't even deliver on that, then they can't deliver on anything, and that would be the release of hostages and prisoners. And I need to hear that from the European part. I need to hear that the Europeans are on the side of the Syrian people when it comes to releases, when it comes to end sieges, when it comes to accountability for crimes, and when it comes to halting the use of indiscriminate weapons and indiscriminate attacks on civilians. It needs to be a far more vocal message, and those who are on the ground who needs to hear that they should not be motivated by keep on fighting, they should be negotiating, they need to hear those messages far more forceful for you, and you need to put those messages to those who can deliver, be it in the Gulf region, be it in Turkey, or be it in Russia and in Iran. That is the European role.
I don't disagree, actually. I think I said that, at least I tried, that I said this exactly. Well, men not tend to speak too loud anyway. But no, in seriousness, I think I said that here, and I said it in Geneva. The spokesperson of the German ministry this afternoon issued a statement on the COI report, where he also stresses accountability. So I think we are doing exactly that. But still, I think we should not forget that. Yes, there has to be a public, clear voice where we stand. I think we do that. Secondly, but also we have to see how we can engage in these negotiations and support those in the negotiations, and that's exactly what we do. And again, not only by words, but by real support, who fight for exactly those principles.
As you can observe, we are a little bit away from ending even this aspect of the conversation, but we are at the end of this panel, so thank you very much, Chris Woods, Lotte Leicht, and Andreas Krüger. And it would be a nice surprise if all of you are back, or most of you are back, at 6:45. It would be also a little expression of respect to our next panelist, amongst them Anwar Albouni and Khaled Rawaz, who are speaking about their torture experiences. Thank you very much.